Reservations for Six by Lindsey J. Palmer. Narrated by Austin Gray. Chapter 1. Nathan's Birthday. The whole thing was perfectly choreographed with the finesse and ease of a Broadway production, still going strong 10 years into its run. Mickey arrived at Giorgio's a minute before their 8 p.m. reservation, headed to the table in the back, and set the show in motion. Ordering the first two bottles of red, the bruschetta, and olives, and burrata, then setting out place cards that had grown frayed after a decade of use. Mickey would be at one end, with her husband Mateo to her left, beside Louisa, and Nathan would sit at the other end. The birthday crown was placed ceremoniously at his setting, with Abe and Amy on the opposite side. Everything in place, Mickey assumed her spot, touched up her lipstick, and waited for her husband and her four best friends to arrive. Spotting Nathan's boyish frame, Mickey shouted out, "Birthday boy coming through," knowing it would cause him to bloom with embarrassment. Nathan was followed by his wife, Louisa, just 2 inches shy of his 6 feet, though she seemed to have grown even taller since having the twins a couple years ago. Her curly hair had a personality of its own, and she'd always been broad-shouldered, but motherhood had enhanced her curves, making Mickey's best friend even more beautiful in Mickey's eyes. Louisa heaved a cake box onto the table and shed her giant parka. "Man, it's cold out there. I'll never, ever get used to January in Massachusetts." Mickey cupped her palms into makeshift earmuffs to warm Louisa's ears. "New England winters will put hair on your chest." "Exactly what I need." "Here, drink up, warm up." Mickey distributed generous pours of wine. Nathan took a gulp. "Thanks. It's been a day." "A birthday," Abe appeared, clapping him on the back. "A resident elder. How does it feel on the front lines, forging forth into a new decade?" Nathan groaned. "It feels like creaking knees, a receding hairline, and—" Mickey cut him off. "Such bleak talk. I think you meant to say it feels wonderful to be surrounded by the love of my nearest and dearest."
"Sure, that."
Nathan finished his wine and reached for the bottle in one swoop. Abe extended a folder to Louisa, stamped in all caps, "Ms. Bauer." "This was in your mailbox." The two were colleagues at the local high school, River Mill, where Abe taught history and Louisa had climbed her way up from English teacher to vice principal. They'd both started on the same day nearly a dozen years ago and been pals ever since. Mickey intercepted the folder. "Come on, no one's getting sucked into work tonight." She directed everyone to their seats as if they didn't know them by heart, and Abe plunked the birthday crown onto Nathan's head.
"You really are balding, aren't you?"
Nathan shoved him away with affection. "How long until our other halves show up?" Mickey said to Abe. She was marooned at one end of the table, flanked by empty seats on either side.
"Any minute now,"
said Abe, always the optimist. "Well, I predict they don't make it in time for apps," Mickey replied. She was right. The tablecloth was already a wreck of breadcrumbs and olive oil, and their spouses were on the verge of ordering for them when Amy and Mateo swooped in one after the other, all apologies. A bug in Amy's code, a crisis on Mateo's team, blah, blah, blah. They'd all heard it before. The only people who believed Amy and Mateo would ever leave their offices before 8 o'clock were Amy and Mateo themselves. Mateo made the rounds kissing cheeks before landing at Mickey and massaging his wife's shoulders. "That hits the spot," she sighed. "Today was all upper body." Mickey, a gym owner and triathlete, was perpetually in need of stretching and loosening.
"This is why you married me, right?"
"That, and you knocking me up," it still amused Mickey all these years later. How she had to let out her wedding gown to accommodate her burgeoning belly. It had long ago returned to six-pack tot, and the baby bump had grown into a full-fledged teenager. Melody, age 17, was as feisty as her mother, as natural of a leader as her father, and the treasure of her parents' lives. Amy nodded hello to her friends, then took her place next to Abe, nuzzling his nose. "You two are still such lovebirds," Mickey said. "And after how long?" Everyone picked up on the cue, bellowing in unison, 10 years. The first of these birthday dinners had been exactly a decade ago, on Nathan's 30th birthday. Louisa and Mateo had invited along Abe and Amy, their respective co-workers. It was a setup, and an instant match. The six of them had been gathering at Giorgio's for all six of their birthdays every year since. It was a tradition, a good luck charm, and a celebration all rolled into one. They ordered their usuals: lasagna, chicken parmigiana, cacio e pepe, spaghetti carbonara, chicken marsala, mushroom risotto, caprese salad. Most of them had been on various diets over the years, flirted with paleo or Whole30, eliminated sugar or gluten, abstained from drinking on weekdays or altogether. But when it came to each other's birthdays, they were all in. Even Mickey, who otherwise stuck to a clean vegetarian regimen that, along with her rigorous workouts, occasionally fooled people into thinking that she and her teenage daughter were sisters. Louisa watched her friend dig into her mountain of pasta. Mickey did everything with gusto. Always had. It was one of the first things that had drawn Louisa to her. Mickey had been Louisa's RA her freshman year of college, the older girl's room a revolving door of fun. Despite her busy social calendar, the senior had made space for Louisa, drawing her out of her shyness and into her inner circle. Louisa had soon realized that as popular as Mickey was, her friends were party friends, mostly up for big nights out and dancing around to blasting music while pre-gaming for big nights out. Whereas Louisa was someone Mickey could truly confide in. The two of them often lounged around in their PJs and stayed up half the night talking. They swapped stories of lonely childhoods, Mickey being a late-in-life accident of parents who were over it after having raised three sons, and Louisa being the only child of two workaholics who had little time or patience for parenting. They talked about their classes and crushes, their fears and fantasies of the future, and by the end of the semester, they were inseparable. They'd only grown closer in the nearly 2 decades since. Mickey looked even better now than she had back then, while Louisa was still hanging on to a handful of the 50 pounds she'd gained while carrying her twins. It was impossible for her to fathom fitting exercise into her day or abstaining from the stress chocolate stashed in her desk. Watching her friend eat so heartily, Louisa consciously pushed aside her envy. She preferred to feel in awe, thinking of Mickey like a muse who existed on a higher plane. Mickey noticed Louisa observing her. "Open wide, Lou," she delivered an expertly coiled forkful of spaghetti into her mouth. "So good, right?" Louisa nodded, mouth full. Mickey didn't think any less of her because of her love handles. Plus, the food was heavenly. Louisa couldn't believe that this and the Kraft mac and cheese she served her kids could both be called pasta. The group ate family style, everyone reaching over everyone else for bites and bottles and little plates piled with forkfuls of this and that. The waiters knew them, the birthday crew, and flitted about the table, refilling glasses and bread baskets, uncorking bottles of wine, and bringing out more sauces without being asked. An observer might be excused for thinking the friends didn't have much to say to each other, since few words were exchanged during this phase of the evening. In truth, no one felt the need to drum up conversation for conversation's sake. They were comfortable, at home in their little sextet, bellies growing fuller and heads fuzzier with good wine. Louisa took a break from her plate to sit back and marvel at her life. Sure. She was so sleep-deprived she could have used an entire year to catch up, and most days felt like a breakneck sprint, her to-do list stalking her like a sleazy creditor. But that was expected, given her demanding, thankless job at the school and her demanding general.